رحم الله من قرأ سورة الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين. الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، يقول الله في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وإن من شيعته لإبراهيم. The first of our salawat in honor of Rasulullah Muhammad صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم. Second loud salawat in honor of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen عليه السلام. A third with your loudest voices in honor of the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asr wa al-Zaman. There's one more request for the brothers to come closer to the front. Please try and fill as many of the gaps as you can. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Respected brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Last night we discussed Islamophobia, but how about Shia-phobia? Indeed, you find that amongst the groups in the world today, within any religion, that faces bigotry, prejudice, and hate is no doubt the Shia of Ahl al-Bayt alayhim as-salam. And this indeed has been the case since the very beginning of the religion of Islam. It's somewhat hypocritical of Muslims that when they're at the brunt of facing Islamophobia, when they face hate or they face prejudice or they face bigotry from outside of the religion of Islam, they call it Islamophobia. But when there's bigotry and hate within the religion of Islam towards the Shia, you find that no one talks of Shia phobia. Indeed, you find that the industry of Shia phobia and those people who spread prejudice and bigotry and hatred towards the Shia has been around for many years. Today in the world, you find that many Shia have to face hatred and lies and defamation against them or against the teachings of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. You find, for example, that many of us within this hall may have known someone or another who was killed simply because of their Shia identity. As in those of you who are from Afghanistan or from Pakistan or from Iraq or from Iran or from Lebanon or from Syria or, for example, from the Hijaz or from Bahrain, would have come across a person in one way or the other who was killed simply because of their identity as being a Ja'fari Muslim. As in, not because they committed a crime or because, for example, they had been insulting towards anyone. Rather, their only crime was that a group of people in their society hated the Shia and that they decided that they'd massacre that person or a group of people. In some cases, you hear a whole bomb exploding, like the bomb blast in Kuwait last year in the holy month of Ramadan. Or, for example, in Pakistan, when professionals were killed simply because of them being lovers of Ahlul Bayt. Or, for example, the Hazara community who have faced attack after attack after attack. Indeed, you find, therefore, that there have been publications which are the very root of Shia phobia. You find within these publications, they are given to generations of children, and that these generations of children are taught that the Shia believe in so-and-so, or that the Shia have so-and-so. And I remember reading one particular piece which said that the Shia are a group of people who have tails. Do any of you have tails here? If any of you do, send the tail on a postcard to me, so that we could see your Shia tail. They would spread it far and wide that the Shia were a group of people who had tails. Likewise, they would spread, for example, that never eat the food of the Shia. You know, in certain parts of the world, there is such a Shia phobia that they say to you, if a Shia invites you to their house, be careful of their food. Why? Because of the fact that they'll spit in the food. I admit that there's been certain dishes I've wondered what's gone in there. But the reality is that I don't think that there has been spitting taking place. Likewise, one of the greatest insults which highlights the Shia phobia is regarding Muharram. Yes, you find that they spread this to the children as the children grow up. That the Shia, when they gather in the month of Muharram, what do we do? Supposedly, we gather in the month of Muharram, we switch off the lights and commit zina with one another. Yes. Would you believe in Pakistan in the mid-80s, and those who know Pakistani politics will know what I'm referring to. In Pakistan in the mid-80s, there would be publication after publication of Shia phobia. What they would do is that they would publish books, for example, a book called The 12 Months of the Islamic Calendar. And within that book, what do you find? You find that within that book, it's clearly written that the Shia gather in the month of Muharram. They switch off the lights of the mosque, and their men and their women commit adultery with one another. I ask all of you that when we come and congregate in Muharram, you come to congregate first and foremost to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes. Secondly, you congregate to build a relationship with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Thirdly, you congregate to be able to reflect on his family and the principles of ethics of his family so that you can apply those lessons into your life on an everyday basis. But sadly, you find that this Shia phobia is as rife as Islamophobia, if not more. Some people think Islamophobia is the worst. Islamophobia exists, no doubt. But Shia phobia is inculcated to a level which affects us in terms of faith, in terms of economy, and in terms of society. What do I mean? Faith-wise, publications are written where the Shia are not part of the faith of the religion of Islam. When it comes to the groups who are Muslim, you know, sometimes you have those categories. It's written that the Shia are out of the fold of the religion of Islam. They are not to be counted as Muslims. How many times have you heard lectures on YouTube where the lecturer says there are Muslims and also there are Shia? You're like, hold on, buddy, aren't I one of you? As in, aren't I one of the Muslims? No, the Muslim said to the Shia. Secondly, economically, there are countries, because of their Shia phobia, do not allow the Shia to rise into prominent positions. Yes. What do they do? There are now job application forms which ask you, are you Sunni or are you Shia? You have to tick the box, and you find that some of the Shia know very well that the moment you tick the box and the box says that you're Shia, there's a slim chance you're going to get that job. Or even if you get the job, say you're working in human resources, yes? You want to go up a level. Or say you're working as an associate. You want to try one day to become executive or to become a partner. Yes, there are countries in the Middle East where because the demographic is 85% Shia and 15% others, they either give citizenship to the odd Bangladeshi. The poor guy cannot believe his eyes, yes. The Bangladeshi thinks to himself, I'm living in Bahrain. I used to be someone who the Bahraini would not even look at when they talk to. But to equal the demographic of Bahrain, because there's a Shia phobia, and there's hatred and bigotry against the Shia in Bahrain, where some of them will never rise in their jobs, what do? You give more citizenship to the Bangladeshi. You give citizenship to the Ba'athi Iraqi, the lover of Saddam, because many of them are either in Qatar or in Jordan or in Bahrain. Where else will you find them? That those governments will welcome them Or you'll make sure that the Shia will never rise to the top. As in, I have friends who work in Bahrain who aren't Bahraini. They say to me, it's blatant when the jobs go up for people to come and take them, that when they know you're a Shia, the Shia phobia suddenly emerges. Yes. So on the level number one of faith, we're discounted from the faith. On the level of economy, you can't get the top jobs. On the level socially, there are certain social gatherings which are not allowed if you're a Shia. Yes. If you're a Shia, for example, in some countries, and I'll come to them towards the end of the lecture, to have a majlis like this, you're not allowed. Alhamdulillah that we have a godly environment like the environment of Canada. Alhamdulillah. And I say this with full confidence that on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look at the leadership of this country and say that you welcome people of different faiths, different beliefs, and you did not have a bigotry against them like how the Muslims have a bigotry against the fellow Muslims. Yes. Not to say that all the Muslims have Shia phobia. On the contrary, we have a number of our brothers, for example, in Pakistan. They'll attend the majalis of Ahlul Bayt and not miss one of them. Yes. There are lovers of Ahlul Bayt in Pakistan, for example. In Iraq, you have lovers of Ahlul Bayt who will go to the shrine of Imam Al-Kadhim in Muharram and they'll have a love for the Ahlul Bayt. In Egypt, you have people who love Al-Muhammad and will never let go. The worst of the worst who have this Shia phobia exported are the Salafi Wahhabis. Yes. They, of course, do not like to be called Wahhabi. So I'll give them the term Salafi. They say that they're the ones who export this, no doubt. And that's why you find that within our communities today, many of the Shia, there's now suddenly a slight fear within them. Why? Because they see the Shia phobia. Some of them begin to tell their kids, don't say that you're Shia. Yes, there are certain countries, like the United Arab Emirates, for example, where some of the Shia there who are locals, and I refer to the locals, many of them will tell their children that do not say that you're Shia. Why? Because we want to maintain our business relationships. Yes. If you say you're Shia, then I can't maintain my business relationship. And how much man loves business. Likewise, they'll say, for example, when it comes to your prayers, they'll tell their kids blatantly that do not pray like the Shia. Say, but hold on, the United Arab Emirates, for example, is a Maliki nation. Yes, they pray with their hands by their side. But subhanAllah, sometimes when you yourself begin to be your own enemy, you begin to build an inferiority complex in yourself. And that's why you see India, for example, has many who are not Shia today, who originally were all Shia. But the reason they're not Shia today was taqiyya, too much taqiyya, they forgot their Shiaism. You ask him, what's your name? He says, my name's Sayyid Hassan al-Husseini. Have you ever heard of a more Shia name than that? As in, you can't get more Shia than that than unless you're called Sayyid Ali al-Ali al-Ali. Yes? Sayyid Hassan al-Husseini, you say to him, what are you? He says, I'm a member of Ahlul Sunnah. But I think my grandma said our great-grandfather was Sayyid. That person, what happens then is, because there's such a Shia phobia, many of the Shia begin to fear for themselves. They begin to say that I'm not going to get involved. Therefore, you find that what do? Do you openly come out and say you're Shia? Or is it just to title yourself better to say that you're Muslim so that you afford all of these difficulties? Better to say that you're Muslim rather than you're Shia. Tonight, let's examine Shia phobia in contrast to last night's Islamophobia, in order that we see how did the Ahlul Bayt deal with Shia phobia. Who was the first to be at the receiving end of Shia phobia, number one? Number two, how did they try and destroy his character because of their hatred? Number three, and of the utmost importance, which different methods have been used with Shia phobia? Number four, how can we make sure that we do not fall into the trap of destroying our own image? Number five, which countries in the world today have the most Shia phobia? And in which way have they shown the Shia phobia? And number six, in which way did they seek to destroy the history of the Shia by destroying the graves of the beloved ones of Al-Muhammad? Let's examine this and dissect the topic in complete depth. Shia phobia, where did it begin? Canada? No. America? No. The Middle East? Somewhere in the Middle East. When? Shia phobia began with the very main man of Shiaism, Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa Muhammad. Because naturally, we are the Shia of Ali. When we say we're the Shia of Ali, In the same way, Ibrahim was the Shia of Nuh in the Quran. Surah 37, verse 83 mentions the word Shia. وَإِنَّ مِنْ شِيعَتِهِ لَإِبْرَاهِيم. One of the Shia of Ibrahim, of Nuh, was Nabi Ibrahim. Shia means what? Means I'm a follower of somebody. Yes, you could be the Shia of Ibrahim, you could be the Shia of Abu Sufyan, you could be Shia of Liverpool Football Club, you could be Shia of anyone. You follow someone, you're the Shia of that group of people. In the Quran, Allah says that Ibrahim was from the Shia of Nuh. That means that theologically, Ibrahim was of the followers of Nabi Nuh. Likewise with us, we are of the Shia of Ali. Meaning what? That we believe that the only man who is able to describe to you the teachings of the Quran and the life of Rasulullah in precision is Ali ibn Abi Talib. Yes? When I say I'm the Shia of Ali, I could have been the Shia of many others. There were many other candidates who claimed that they could teach me the Sunnah of Rasul. Yes? Abu Bakr, the first Khalifa, Umar ibn al-Khattab, the second Khalifa. Others, Abu Huraira, Aisha. Others who came later on, Malik bin Anas, Abu Hanifa. When I say I'm the Shia of Ali, why do I say this? Because I'm following the Sunnah of Salman and Abu Dhar, Ammar and Miqdad, Jabir and Khuzaymah bin Thabit al-Ansari, Maytham al-Tammar, Hujr bin Adi, Amr bin Hamik al-Khuza'i, Kumail bin Ziyad, Malik al-Ashtar. They followed Ali ibn Abi Talib, not because mommy and daddy were Shia, but because they saw that the man who could tell me the most about the meanings of the Quran, the abrogated and the abrogations, the different layers of interpretations, the reasons of the revelations, no one was greater than Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. When the Holy Prophet would say, I am the city of knowledge and Ali is its gate. What is he saying? That if you want to know me, then follow this man. Therefore, what were we called? We were called Shi'at Ali. Shi'at Ali at the beginning were only a handful. Yes, today, 300 million call themselves the Shia of Imam Ali. At the beginning, there was only a handful who held on to Amir al-Mu'mineen. And that handful had to face, as their master had to face, Shia phobia beyond belief. Why? Because what's Shia phobia? The definition is hatred and bigotry towards the Shia. Who's the symbol of the Shia? Ali ibn Abi Talib, yes? You found that the Shia phobia hatred to Amir al-Mu'mineen was orchestrated in different ways. In which way? The first of the ways was to bring up children cursing Ali ibn Abi Talib. The first way, yes? As in today, if you think that it's hard for you, do you know how hard it was for the Shia in those early days? Kids would go around either abusing Imam Ali or cursing Imam Ali. I want all of you tonight to do something on Google. Go on sahihmuslim.com. When you go on Sahih Muslim, I want you to write two words in the Arabic language, and this goes to all the listeners on the television, on the internet. Write two words, or sit one of your friends from another school in Islam, sit them down next to you, yes, and say to them, let's just look in Sahih Muslim, next to Sahih al-Bukhari is two of the most famous works. Let's write the word yashtim, yes, and the word yal'an. Let's write these. Shatm is abuse. La'in is a dua asking Allah to withdraw His mercy from an individual. In Sahih Muslim, there are two unbelievable forms of Shia phobia like you will never see in your life. You see how many of our brothers from other schools in Islam say, but we love Ali as well. Don't they always say to you, you're not the only ones who love Ali. We love Ali. Okay, do you love Ali? Let's see the Shia phobia in Sahih Muslim. The first hadith, Muawiyah, son of Abu Sufyan, asks Sa'ad bin Abi Waqqas, Sa'ad, why don't you curse Ali ibn Abi Talib? Hold on. I thought Ali ibn Abi Talib is the fourth Khalifa of Islam. Look how early in Islam the question is raised. Sa'ad, why don't you curse Ali ibn Abi Talib? Muawiyah is asking Sa'ad. Muawiyah bin Abi Sufyan, father of Yazid, son of Abu Sufyan, who many Muslims on YouTube today, you'll see the videos. There are hundreds of videos. Muawiyah, may Allah be pleased with him. Muawiyah, Khalifa of the Muslimin. Muawiyah, uncle of the Muslimin. Muawiyah, everything of the Muslimin. Yes? Every title you want, they give you about Muawiyah. No problem. Muawiyah asked Sa'ad bin Abi Waqqas, why don't you curse Ali ibn Abi Talib? Yes? Sa'ad bin Abi Waqqas replies, how could I curse Ali ibn Abi Talib when Ali has three things which I wish I had? What are they? Number one, Rasulullah saying to him, Ali, you are to me like Harun was to Musa. Except there's no prophet after me. One of the greatest honors Amir al-Mu'mineen received. What's Rasulullah saying about him? You are to me like Aaron was to Moses. But there is no prophet after me. So that's number one. Number two, on the day of Khaybar, yes? All of us wanted that banner. Who Rasulullah described the man and said, tomorrow I'll give a banner to a man. Allah and me love him. And he and me love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he goes into the battlefield, he goes and he never returns except with victory. He said he took the saliva, placed it in the eye. Imam Ali had an eye infection that day. Rasulullah took his saliva, put it in the eye of Amir al-Mu'mineen. The moment Amir al-Mu'mineen had that saliva in his eyes, the first thing he said was, I'm like a demon possessed. It's for days like this that my mother gave birth to me. Yes? And you don't want to face Ali ibn Abi Talib when he says things like that. Number three, on the day of Mubahala, when Rasulullah, the Quran said, bring your sons, we'll bring our sons. Bring your woman, we'll bring our woman. Bring yourselves, we'll bring yourselves. All of us were wondering, who does Allah view as the self of Muhammad? Yes? Who does Allah view as the very nafs of Muhammad? He said that day, the nafs title was given to Ali ibn Abi Talib. He said, how can I curse a man who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given those three accolades? You find that Muslim finds it normal to narrate such a narration. That Muawiyah says, why don't you curse Ali ibn Abi Talib? Tell me, my brothers in Ahlul Sunnah, I ask you a question. When you tell us, the Shia, that you people love Ali and we love Ali, in early Islam, you don't see that there was a hatred to Ali ibn Abi Talib. You don't see that there are people asking each other, why don't you curse Ali? In the same Sahih Muslim, Virtues of Ali ibn Abi Talib, that's the name of the chapter, in Sahih Muslim again, this is Sunni literature, not Shia literature. In Sahih Muslim again, in the virtues of Imam Ali, there is a hadith where the word abuse and the word la'na are both used against Imam Ali. Sahel bin Sa'ad says that one of the offspring of Marwan became the governor of Medina. He said when he became the governor of Medina, he ordered me. Amarahu an yashtima Aliyan. Yes. He ordered him to abuse Ali ibn Abi Talib. Subhanallah. He became governor of Medina. He is ordering him, abuse Ali ibn Abi Talib. Sahel turned around, he refused. He said, I'm not going to curse Ali ibn Abi Talib, no way. The reply then came was what? Okay, then say what? Say, la'natullah on Abu Turab. Yes. Say that at the very least. You know what that is? That is Shia phobia. That is when a person from a very young age is taught in a society that you should curse Ali ibn Abi Talib. If not, then at least do la'na on Abu Turab. And that would be normal for them amongst them. When I read Sahih Muslim and I see a la'na being done on Abu Turab or shatim of Abu Turab, I look at myself today and I wonder, when I see Shia phobia, is it anything like Ali ibn Abi Talib saw? Do you know how many years, 60 years on the pulpits of Bani Umayyah, they would curse Ali ibn Abi Talib every single week? The first way, therefore, in which there was Shia phobia was to try and do la'na or insult Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. That's number one. Number two, if you couldn't do la'na or you couldn't insult him, then what was the second way? Kill off all his companions who were his Shia. Yes? Because when you found out that someone was a Shia of Ali, what do you do to them? You think today in Pakistan, when the Shia are being killed, or in Bahrain when the Shia are being killed, or in Malaysia and other places when the Shia are being killed, you think this is the first time there's been Shia phobia? Go and taste and drink from the fountain of Maytham al-Tammar and Kumail bin Ziyad, yes? Maytham al-Tammar, when Ibn Ziyad caught him, you know what Shia phobia levels had reached? Ibn Ziyad said, where's the lovers of Abu Turab? He caught Maytham al-Tammar. Maytham had been told by Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. He said to him, Maytham, are you ready one day to die loving me? You know there'll be a period of Shia phobia against us. Maytham would turn around and say, Imam, it would be my honor. How will I die? He said, you'll die while you're praising me. He said, Imam, it would be my honor to be sacrificed while praising you. You know what they done to Maytham? Took him to one of the trees of Kufa. Yes. Ibn Ziyad said to him, I'm going to kill you. He said, my Mola told me that society will reach a level where his Shia will be butchered. If you're going to kill me, my Mola told me that you're going to kill me. Ibn Ziyad said to him, very well, I won't kill you. While Maytham was on the tree crucified, He'd sing the blessings and the praise of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Yes, if you think it's hard for the Shia today, this man's crucified, singing the praise of Ali, one after the other. Until what happens? Until Ibn Ziyad orders for Maytham's tongue to be cut off and for him to be killed. Yes. Maytham is one. Then you look at others. Kumail bin Ziyad. Hajjaj bin Yusuf al-Thaqafi looks at Kumail. He says to him, leave Abu Turab, I will not behead you. All of you have read Dua Kumail on a Thursday night. Yes. He says to him, if you leave Abu Turab, I will not behead you. Kumail replies with one of the most exquisite lines you'll ever reply. You know what he said? He said, show me a way better than Abu Turab, I'll go towards that way. SubhanAllah. Yes. Is there a way better than the way of Abu Turab? I ask everybody who listens to this lecture, that when you tell me, why am I a Shia of Ali? Show me a way better than Ali ibn Abi Talib, I'll go and join it. Yes. Why do you think? You think I have nothing else to do in this world, that I cannot join any other path? When I'm a Shia of Ali, it's because I looked at all the paths and I found the path of Abu Turab being the best path. The path of spirituality, the path of ethics, the path of dignity. Kumail bin Ziyad, Amr bin Hamak al-Khuza'i, lover of Ali ibn Abi Talib, they behead him and parade his head on the streets. Kumail bin Ziyad, Maytham al-Tammar, Amr bin Hamak al-Khuza'i, Rushad al-Hajari, they cut his tongue, put him on the streets. Hujr bin Adi al-Kindi and his son, they behead him, put him on the streets. The second way in which Shia phobia was originated was what? The first was to insult Ali in the books. The second was to make sure that Ali's Shia were beheaded one by one. Because they knew Ali's Shia were the creme de la creme of their society. The intellectuals, the dignified, the people of morals. They would get rid of them one by one, massacre them. You know, subhanAllah, you see Baghdad today. They say there are walls in Baghdad which were built from the cement on the bodies of Shia who were buried alive. Yes, Baghdad. They used to get the Shia of Ali ibn Abi Talib. You think in Canada I have it hard being a Shia over here? Or in the United Arab Emirates I have it hard being a Shia? In Baghdad, they would get the Shia, they would get him alive. They'd bury him alive. You'd find, for example, Hajjaj bin Yusuf al-Thaqafi. What would he do? Hajjaj would say, kill the Shi'i, but and make me bread. But when you make the bread, put the blood with the dough. The bread tastes much better when it's the blood of a Shi'i. Yes? That's Shia phobia. Ali ibn Abi Talib, the first thing they did with their Shia phobia was insult him. Secondly, kill off his Sahaba. Thirdly, look at this third point that they did. Bring narrators into the books of hadith who were known for their hatred of Ali. Allahu Akbar, yes? Because what happens if you're a narrator of hadith and you hate Ali ibn Abi Talib, and I say to you that you mind narrating a hadith about Islamic history, if you hate Amir al-Mu'mineen, are you going to narrate a hadith positive for him or negative? Negative. How many times have you come across a hadith where you're like, that doesn't sound like Ali ibn Abi Talib, yes? Do you know why? Because they made sure that if you're going to be Shia phobic, the best thing to do is what? Get Ali's worst enemies and make them write all of the hadiths. Yes, I remember, have you read the hadith? Fatima is a part of me. Whoever angers her, angers me. And whoever angers me, angers Allah. We know what that hadith is about. Do you know what is the sharh of this hadith? Yes, they got all the enemies of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, Al-Karabis, Al-Baghdadi, Maswar bin Makrama, the most famous enemies of Ali ibn Abi Talib, they started to write hadiths. You know what they wrote? They wrote this hadith was about Ali ibn Abi Talib when he angered Fatima al-Zahra alayhi salam. Ali ibn Abi Talib angered Fatima al-Zahra. Fatima al-Zahra said, my greatest blessing in my life was to be next to Amir al-Mu'mineen. Yes. Ali ibn Abi Talib says about Fatima al-Zahra, a flower came from heaven, went to heaven, left her fragrance in my mind. Tell me, there is a problem between the two? No, there isn't. But I hate you. I have a phobia against you and your lovers. I hate Maytham and I hate Kumail and I hate Malik al-Ashtar and I hate Muhammad, son of Abu Bakr. So you know what I'm going to do? Not only will I kill them all off, I'm going to stab you. believe in tawassul. So you believe in the temporary marriage? I believe in the temporary marriage. Where in the Quran, chapter 4, verse 24? فَمَا اسْتَمْتَعْتُمْ بِهِ مِنْهُنَّ فَآتُوهُنَّ أُجُورَهُنَّ فَرِيضًا. Those who you're going to have a temporary marriage with, then what do? You give them their dowry for that period. I believe in the temporary marriage, and it's part of the teachings of Ahlul Bayt. You believe in infallibility? Yes, I do. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse about Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمْ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. اللهم صل على محمد. Oh, you believe in taqiyya? I'm proud to believe in taqiyya. Why? Because Nabi Musa's closest friend, Allah said he concealed his faith in Surah 40, verse 28. Ammar bin Yasir concealed his faith when he was being tortured in Surah 16, verse 106. In Surah 3, verse 28, Allah says, don't take the disbelievers as your friends, except if you're concealing what's inside you in that difficult time. Likewise, I believe that the Imams themselves said, taqiyya is our religion and the religion of our forefathers. That's my sectarian identity. Yes? There's a difference between sectarian identity and sectarian ideology. A sectarian identity is when I say that this is my beliefs. If you want to agree with them, you could agree. But if you don't agree, I'm not going to call you a non-Muslim. No. I'll say that you are under the banner of La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. A sectarian ideology is one that looks at every other Muslim as a kafir except them. Yes? Wahhabism, sectarian identity, sectarian ideology. Yes? It's an ideology and an identity that looks to do what? My sectarian identity is what? I'm a Shia. My sectarian ideology is what? Is that we should try and maintain the unity of the Muslim Ummah. Wahhabism, sectarian identity, Salafi. Sectarian ideology, Shia, dogs, Shia, pigs, Shia, Rawafid. Shia are to be seen as being liars, hypocrites. Look in the books of them. Because how do you spread Shia phobia? How do you spread it? $1 billion invested into Pakistan in the 80s. How much? $1 billion. Pakistan, India, Afghanistan, other countries to build nations who are Shia-phobic. Yes. How do they do it? They publish books of the following authors. Ibn Taymiyyah, number one. Yes. Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, number two. And if you go to Saudi Arabia, you'll find their books are clear. Ibn Taymiyyah, Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab. Now, I don't mind. You want to say you're Salafi? I don't mind. You say La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. I have to say that you're a Muslim. But when you begin to have an ideology that's sectarian, that I fear for my life when I pray in Saudi Arabia, because I could be killed simply because I'm seen as what? As a dog, as a pig, as a person who is the person of innovation, and a person who is the worst of human beings. Yes, the ulama are very open. Read Ibn Taymiyyah, Minhaj al-Sunnah, the way he talks about the Rawafid, talks about us as liars, as hypocrites, as the people of hell. Look at Abdul Wahhab. Yes, Muhammad bin Abdul Wahhab, who the Wahhabis are named after. Look at his book, Risala, in relation to the Rawafid. Very clear that these are the people of the bottom of hell, the Rawafid. Tell me, when you bring up books like this in Saudi Arabia, and you know where these books went? Birmingham, London, Toronto, New York. Wallah, go and look at the bookshelves of some of our centers in the West, and I'll show you where the next bomb blast is going to come from. Because what Saudi Arabia done better than anybody else was make sure that Shia phobia was exported with petrol dollars. Yes? 1979 revolution happened. The moment the 1979 revolution happened, they used to spread out videos. Wallah, I'll never forget going to Umrah. When I was leaving the hotel, they gave us this free like goodie bag, you know. And me thinking this is something nice, let's see what's in there. Remember the old cassettes you used to listen to? Yes. I was listening. This tape has been produced to tell you about the Shia Zionist revolution of 1979. Yes. That these Shia are what? That these Shia are kuffar. They are the worst of God's creation. Yes. When that gets exported, what do you find? Subhanallah, you find that generations of kids, you think when you saw in Syria the kid beheading, saying that this is a Shia I'm killing, or those who were drinking the blood of the Shia, or those in Spica who killed the innocent Iraqis up north, yes? All of these. Where does this come from? This doesn't come from sectarian identity. I don't mind if a Muslim says, I'm Sunni, I'm Shia, I'm whatever. But sectarian ideology we have no space for. An ideology that seeks to break between the Muslims.
By the same time, we the Shia have to be careful that people don't become Shia-phobic because of our actions. Some of our actions, maybe if I sit here on the minbar of Ahlul Bayt, and I sit, and I've just said that they used to do la'na on Imam Ali, they used to abuse Imam Ali, and I sit here and I do la'na on those individuals who other schools in Islam represent, then a person has the right to be Shia-phobic. Yes. There is on YouTube people who've sat here, la'na on so-and-so, la'na on so-and-so. Of course someone's going to be Shia-phobic. Likewise, if I go out in the streets, there are certain acts I say I'm going to represent Imam al-Hussein. I love Imam al-Hussein. When you're going to do those acts, people are going to grow up hating you when you do things like that. You have to not say that these are all wrong, but rather say there's a time and place for everything. There's a context for everything. I shouldn't harm the image of Islam. Imam al-Sadiq used to say, "Kunu lana zainan, wala takunu alayna shaynan. Habibuna ila al-nas, wala tubaghiduna alayhim." Imam al-Sadiq used to say, be a source of adornment for us, not a source of disappointment for us. Yes? Let the people love us, don't let the people hate us. Wallah, there's one hadith he says, I'll never forget. They asked him that the Sunni brothers and sisters have funerals, they have salah. Can we go to their funerals? Can we go to their salah? He said, go to their funerals. Pray behind them. So they turn around and they say, Ja'far has truly given the best manners to his Shia. Subhanallah. Imam al-Sadiq, why did he say that? Sometimes someone might come here and say, this is a Sunni Shia issue. It's not. It's an issue that the Salafis have built to try and destroy the Sunni and Shia world. The Salafis with their petrol dollars, and do you know how much they exported it? Subhanallah. Where did Saudi Arabia go recently on holiday when he went with his entourage on the golden escalator of the plane? Where did they go? Indonesia. Where's the biggest majority of Muslims in the world? Indonesia. Wahhabism and Salafism dying in the Middle East slowly. So what do you do? Go to Indonesia. Why? Because you have 200 million Muslims in Indonesia. Try and get them to be Salafi before they become Shia. Taj al-Muluk, one of our brothers in Indonesia a few years ago, was put in prison for 2 years. They tried to sentence him. Why? Oh, he's blasphemous. Wallah, no blasphemy. Nothing whatsoever. Just because he's Shia in Indonesia, they've done a conference, anti-Shia, this man was put into prison in Indonesia. Saudi Arabia, what did it say? Go to Indonesia, put money to the people, make sure they don't become Shia. Because the world is looking around and seeing the Shia are getting stronger and stronger every day. In Indonesia, Taj al-Mulk. Malaysia, our brothers in Malaysia, you know they can't have majalis in Muharram, it's banned. It's banned to have a majlis in Muharram in Malaysia. You ask people, where are you going honeymoon? Malaysia. Sometimes a person should think, hold on, where am I going? Yes, what am I doing? And how many of us even know that there are Shia in Malaysia? There are some Afghani Shia never met non-Afghani Shia. Some Lebanese Shia never met non-Lebanese Shia. Some Iraqi Shia never met non-Iraqi Shia. We are all one ummah. All of us interact. Look today, the multicultural cosmopolitan majlis of Aba Abdullah. Yes, where all the people come from different backgrounds with their common denominator being what? The love of Al-Muhammad. You should be lobbying the Malaysian embassy here in Canada. Why is it that our Malaysian brothers and sisters cannot practice their faith? Yes. People can come to five-star resorts in Malaysia and practice what they want. I won't go further than that. But a person cannot come and represent Al-Muhammad. Yes. Subhanallah. Malaysia. Number three, you look, for example, Pakistan. Pakistan, how many good followers of Ahlul Bayt were killed in the last 25 years in Pakistan? Yes. And doctors were targeted, lawyers were targeted, philanthropists were targeted. And even when Para Chinar happened, the Prime Minister, yes, he came, said, give them some money. Money is not enough. Remove those Wahhabi nonsense books that you have in Pakistan. Every mosque gets built in Pakistan, Saudi Arabia, Saudi Arabia, Saudi Arabia. This is a killing field. You're building a world, not just Shia phobia, forget the Shia. You're building a world where Muslims have a phobia of one another. That a person cannot go to a gathering of the Quran without fearing there's going to be a bomb blast. That's Pakistan. Likewise, not just Pakistan. You have other Afghanistan. How many of the Shia butchered simply because they're followers of Al-Muhammad? Yes. No other reason. And as I said, where does all this come from? All of it comes from Saudi Arabia. And all of it is Saudi money to spread Shia phobia. Wallah, they tried in Syria and Iraq to kill off the Shia of Al-Muhammad. Yes. And what a defeat they saw in Syria, and how they were plummeted in Iraq, yes. Destruction, and how wonderful it is. 80% always worry about 20%. It's something so ironic in this world. But with Saudi Arabia, they knew that the greatest form of Shia phobia you could ever have is to destroy the graves of the Shia imams, yes.
That's the greatest form of Shia phobia, that you get rid of the graves of the Imams of Al Muhammad alayhi salam. And what did they do? They made sure when the Wahhabi movement began and when it assumed power after the Ottomans, what was the first thing they did? After they assumed power after the Ottomans, let us go to Jannat al-Baqi. Yes. And when I say let us go to Jannat al-Baqi, I ask you to take your hearts to Jannat al-Baqi. Because tonight is Qasim ibn al-Hasan alayhi salam. Take your hearts to Jannat al-Baqi. You know what they did to your imams' graves? And not just your imams. Wallah, I wish it was just our imams. Imam al-Hasan is not the grandson of Rasulullah. I ask all of you. He's not the grandson of Rasulullah. Tell me, Imam Zain al-Abidin is not the embodiment of knowledge and wisdom. Imam al-Baqir, Imam al-Sadiq, they are not the embodiment of knowledge. You know what they decided to do? They came and they destroyed the graves of the imams. Yes. And it seems that Al Muhammad, their graves one by one are to be destroyed. Fatima al-Zahra, we don't know where her is. Because of the oppression against Fatima al-Zahra, none of us know where her grave is. You ask any Muslim in the world, where is Fatima's grave? No one knows. Then you look, for example, Imam Ali's grave. 92 years, nobody knew where Ali ibn Abi Talib was buried because the Khawarij wanted to take his body out and burn it. He told Imam al-Hasan, Imam al-Hussein, bury me secretly. Until Imam al-Sadiq said, this is where Ali ibn Abi Talib is buried, 90 years later. Likewise, you find that the Imams of Al-Muhammad Jannat al-Baqiyya, the greatest Shia phobia you'll ever see, that they came to the grave of Imam al-Hasan and bombed the grave. And Imam Zain al-Abidin, and Imam al-Baqi, and Imam al-Sadiq, and all of us when we go to Jannat al-Baqi, all of us yearn, let us just touch some of the clay next to the grave of Imam al-Hasan, or next to the grave of Imam Zain al-Abidin, or Imam al-Baqi, or Imam al-Sadiq, but you find that there will be a day. One of the ulama, he narrates, he said, in my dream, I saw Imam al-Hasan talking to Imam al-Hussein. This alim, he says that I had never ever had an experience like this. But he says that one night, I saw in my dream. What did I see? I saw Imam al-Hasan sitting with Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. He said, when I saw them sitting next to each other, I wanted to hear what were they saying. I couldn't see their faces. But from their words, I recognized who it was. He said, the moment I heard their words, my heart began to break. He says, the first to speak was Imam al-Hasan. But Imam al-Hussein was so humbled that he replied back to Imam al-Hasan. Imam al-Hasan, what did he say? Is it fair, my brother, is it fair that they poisoned me but they beheaded you? Allahu Akbar. Is it fair, my brother, is it fair, my brother Hussein, that they poisoned me but they beheaded you? Allahu Akbar. He's saying it humbly because he's hurt as to what happened to Aba Abdullah. But Imam al-Hussein wanted to reply back to him. He said, is it fair, my brother Hassan, is it fair that there are many Zuwar who come towards me but none come towards you? Allahu Akbar. Who goes to Jannat al-Baqiyah tonight? Jannat al-Baqiyah tonight is empty. Is it fair, my brother Hassan, is it fair that many Zuwar come towards me, but no Zuwar come towards you? Karbala tonight is packed. Yes. Karbala, there's no space tonight. Is it fair, my brother Hassan, is it fair that there's a flag on top of my grave and there's no flag on top of you? Allahu Akbar. There's not even a dariyah on top of his grave. Is it fair, my brother Hassan, is it fair that there's a dharih on top of my grave but there's no dharih on top of you? Allahu Akbar. Not even a dharih. Listen to this line. Is it fair, my brother Hassan, is it fair that my zuwar are welcomed when they come to visit me, whereas your zuwar are pushed away when they come to visit you.
Very true.
When we go to Imam al-Hasan, we're pushed away. But when we come to Aba Abdullah, we're welcome to Aba Abdullah, aren't we? But then Imam al-Hasan replies back. He sees Imam al-Hussein's emotional now. And the alim says, I heard Imam al-Hasan look towards Imam al-Hussein. What did he say to him? He said to him, Hussein, my brother, don't worry. There'll be a day when people will come to visit me and Zain al-Abidin, Muhammad al-Baqir, Ja'far al-Sadiq, and Umm al-Baneen. And all of them will be looking. Looking for what? Looking for a broken rib in Medina. Allahu Akbar. All of them will be looking for a broken rib in Medina. That made him cry. But can you imagine when he saw Qasim ibn al-Hasan? What did that do to him? And especially when he saw Qasim ibn al-Hasan lying on the ground with the pieces of his body scattered everywhere. He took him back towards the tent, yes? He wanted to stay next to the mother of Qasim, but she remained there. Layla remained there at that moment. Sayyidah Zainab said to him, Aba Abdullah, can you leave? He said to her, yes, why? She said, they don't want to cry in front of you, Aba Abdullah. They don't want to break your heart with what's taken place. The narrations mention that on the night of the 11th of Muharram, all the bodies were lying out in the ground in Karbala. All of them were there. Qasim's body was there. Akbar's body was there. Abbas's body was there. The narrations mention that after they killed Imam al-Hussein, Umar bin Sa'ad called out, I want the horse riders to get ready. And they said to him, why? He said, sharpen the hooves of your horses. They went and sharpened the hooves of the horses. Now they looked at him. He said, I want you to get your horses ready. I want you to trample on the body of the companions of Aba Abdullah. The moment he said that, they said to him, whose body do you want us to trample on first? He replied, trample on the body of Hur bin Yazid al-Riyahi. But Hur bin Yazid al-Riyahi's mother's tribe was there. They said, listen, you've already killed our son. We don't allow you to trample on his body. At that moment he said, Muslim bin Awsajah. But Muslim bin Awsajah had cousins in the army of Yazid. They said, listen, you've killed our son. We don't allow you to trample on his body. He said, Habib ibn Madahir. But some of Habib's tribe were there. They said, you've already killed our son. We don't allow you to trample on the body. The next moment, Umar bin Sa'ad said, okay, if all of them are represented, then trample on the body of the family of Aba Abdullah. They said to him, who first? He replied, Ali al-Akbar. But Ali al-Akbar's family, some of them were present. They said, we don't allow you to touch him. Then he said, whom? They said, Qasim. But Qasim's mother's tribe was in Yazid's army. They said, we don't allow you to touch him. All of you know where I'm heading. He said, trample on Abbas's body. But Shimr was related to Umm al-Baneen. He said, leave Abbas's body. Umar bin Sa'ad then called out, is there anybody that lies on the ground whose mother and father's tribe are not here to protect him? What did they reply? They said, there's only one body that lies on the ground whose mother and father's tribe are not here to protect him. He said to them, whom? They said, Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. He said, very well, O horse riders, ride your horses and trample on the body of Aba Abdullah. Yes. They began to kick the ribs of Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam. Who was in the tent? Zainab was in the tent. She looked towards Imam Zain al-Abidin. She said, auntie, I hear something breaking. What is it? He said to her, auntie, have patience. Those are the bones of my father, Muhammad. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of your tears. Ya Allah, raise us with Muhammad and Al Muhammad. Ya Allah, raise us with the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al Asr wa Zaman. Allow us to be amongst his companions and those who follow his message. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, the majalis, my dear brothers and sisters, The majalis, inshallah, will continue for the next few nights, beginning at the earlier time of 8:30, inshallah. Salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.